Jesus. And this very, like, as if he were like a professor at the university or something similar, does not want to be seen with this marginal rabbi called Jesus of Nazareth. So the text, if you review that third chapter of the Gospel of John, you'll find that the text says, Nicodemus went to find Jesus at night, which is not to be seen. They talk to each other about this human fulfillment, right? This getting to fulfill the will of God and being a person that really brings his or her own life to maturity. And Jesus tells Nicodemus, you know, Nicodemus, you have to be born again. And Nicodemus says, how can that be? How can an adult man go back into the uterus of a woman and be born again, right? And Jesus says, no, not from a woman, from water and the Spirit. And then goes on and says, the Spirit that blows wherever it wants, and nobody knows where it comes from, nobody knows where it goes. So Nicodemus is all puzzled and just leaves, and that finishes the conversation. But what I take this conversation to speak of something called kvir, that you might not be familiar with the word kvir. I have written a book in Italian called Kvir Theology, or Towards a Kvir Theology. And what I mean by that is, the word kvir was, in English, it means like strange or rare, right? It is a word that also in German, there is the word queren, the verb, that means to cross, right? It's like, in English they say straight, a person straight is heterosexual, right? Straight in a line that goes out secure to the goal, and then queer, which is somebody that it's deviated, right? It has gone, something has gone wrong and it's not a straight. That's in English, right? To be used as an insult for homosexual people, queer. They were being insulted with that word queer in the 90s, and some of the activists of these homosexual British groups took the word and say, okay, you are throwing us the word at us because you are saying that we don't fit in your categories, right? Because the categories are maleness, femaleness, and complementarity between the two. And you're right, we don't fit. But wait a minute, it's only us who don't fit? Or isn't it that it's all of us that don't fit in any pre-established category? What it is to grow as a human being, what it is to have your adult identity as something that is originality, that it's a unique piece. Is that, and I believe that sight of God on each one of us is not looking and seeing male and female, black and white, and Serbian and Croat, and I don't believe that. I believe, and I have many quotes also from the Bible to support this, that God is looking at each of us and seeing a unique human being, and seeing a unique and original concretization in time and space of the love and the freedom of God. And I believe that is what the ancient tradition of theology calls divinization. And what the letter to the Galatians in the New Testament says, in Christ Jesus there is no Lord and serf, there is no Greek and Jew, there is no male, female. Why does it say that? What does it mean there is no male and female? Well, it means male and female exist, Jew and Greek or Serb and Croat exist, but please do not hang your identity on that. My identity as an adult person, as a free person, as a loving person, is in a space that's beyond that. And I will never be able to get rid of this. But one thing is to get rid of it, which is impossible, my body and my experience, and another is to let this rule my life, to let this be my box that this kvir is going to break through, to let this be my horizon of realization, and to let this be the principle of organizing my society. So I believe this call of freedom that the existentialists, right, all the philosophers from Sartre and are talking about is like, be there to be yourself. And when we do that, it's always a threatening thing, it's a risky thing. You move into an area that is absolutely beyond any stereotype. The people I admire the most that are maybe old people, that are women and men that inspire me to something beautiful. I believe, okay, if you can be 90 years old and be like this, life is worthy to experience. They are not stereotypical male and females. They are women that have come to old age and they have a sense of entitlement to who they are, right? They have like a way of speaking that I admire because I think, okay, she's not like looking for applause and she's not looking for like others to continue. She's just going her way in a gentle way, but very free in that sense, right? And male that are also old and able to inspire me are also not stereotypical males, but old men that are able to show all their tenderness and vulnerability without being afraid of losing the maleness. And still one more thing, in the church we have people we call saints, right? And saints are inspiring figures that the church believes that are inspired by God. Okay, maybe you have heard of a saint called Saint Joan of Arc. Okay, what is God doing? Inspiring her to do what? To just go into the battle and be a warrior? That doesn't seem to be a fulfillment of the femininity, by no means. But we believe Joan of Arc was inspired by God. So if God was into the business of male and female stereotypes, he would inspire all the women saints to be preferably female, right? And to do all the feminine things, and all the males. Okay, you've heard maybe about Francis of Assisi, right? He's jumping in the fields and calling the flower sisters. Okay, doesn't look like a stereotypical male to me, right? But it's a wonderful saint that the church honors and that it has inspired so many people. So whenever I see a free person, it doesn't matter, male, female, that is able to inspire others, I see somebody that is able to move beyond the stereotypes. And that's why I believe the patriarchal society, it's something that we'll always have with us, but we can have it in a way that it doesn't rule us. Not the patriarchal society, let me take that back. This need to not fall into the patriarchal relationships in the family, in the society. This danger or this possibility will always be there, not the society, yeah? That somebody erases, I don't know if somebody is, but please let me correct that, right? Not the society. The possibility will always be there, like the possibility of abusing freedom is always there, the possibility of violence is always there, let's be realistic, there is no, and that I can link with something Maya said, remember to say that, when she has heard from other conference I do, I quote this idea that comes from Trotsky of the permanent revolution, right? That revolution can be also an alienating enterprise, when we believe that once we get it, then we'll be done, right? And once we get rid of our president, which I wish you all to, everything will be solved. Of course not, right? You know that. But when we were able to call our country, I don't know, like cooperativist or whatever each of you likes, then we'll be finally okay. No, there is not such finally okay. But this is not to discourage anybody to do demonstrations. It's just to encourage that we devise and come together to think of ways that we can keep these counterbalances and that we never let this popular power, the people powers, be delegated on anybody, because we need to keep it in our hands and we need to find ways to articulate that in a very effective way. And the same with the private, intimate situation. It's not to be stressed all day, but you have to be active, ready to think, okay, there is a fallback identity, which is my childhood identity, and that's not evil, it's not bad in a child, but in an adult. If I fall back in my childhood identity, I'll be a woman that feels guilty when she doesn't take care of the people around, because that's my childhood identity with the mother. The mother was taking care of the children, the father also, that I already explained. That's not to say the father should not take care, of course, and this is very good, and it's helping this subjectivity to grow in an open, more open way. But this role of the mother as an object of desire, father cannot substitute. So if I fall back into my childhood identity, I'll be an adult woman that will be fearful of solitude, which is the right name for the patriarchal love. When patriarchy says women know better than men how to love, women are more loving than men, women are more able to sacrifice than men. This, I believe, it's wrong wording, it's misnomers. What is true in patriarchy is women are more afraid of solitude than men, usually. And men are more free. Also, I think this is wrong. It's not true. I believe men are more afraid of dependency than women. But the fear of dependency is not freedom. It's fear of dependency. The fear of solitude is not love. It's fear of solitude. And when you bring together the fear of solitude and fear of dependency, you have the heterosexual patriarchal couple. And it's a disaster, as we all know. And so this is the idea, is that this, I don't look in others and think, ah, all these heteropatriarchal, sorry, all these heteropatriarchal couples and what they do, and that I have a sense, I don't think that is gonna hurt me, on the contrary, that I have a sense that this is a fallback identity, possible always, and that is a responsibility of us all together to grow in our spaces of inner silence and prayer or meditation, however you want to do it, in our interaction with others, in the awareness that that is a possibility, and also knowing that this will happen whenever your life is going into a situation that is a bit overwhelming for you, falling back to these identities. And so, with that, thank you.